Beneath the surface of my anxious imagination beckons a calmness that is found in you alone. It washes over every doubt, every imperfection. Jesus, your presence is the comfort of my soul. There's nowhere I'd rather be when you're singing over me. Thank you.
It's taking me longer to walk up the stairs, though. Church, can I get a praise the Lord? How about that Super Bowl? Right. Hey, anybody know anything that's going on with this impeachment? You know, let's try this again because I thought I was in the house of the Lord. Can I get a praise the Lord? All right, that's better. That's better. I'm sorry I brought that other stuff in here, but I'm in the house of God. When I'm in the house of God, I'm expecting to hear some excitement. Not for me. This isn't for me up here. This is for him up there. And you know what? If we can hear clapping and screaming when our kids are graduating, if we can hear when things are good, when our games win, if we can hear louder noises when we're arguing or our neighbors are arguing, screaming at each other, why can't we scream for the Lord? Come on, let's get a praise the Lord up in here this morning. You know, I had my message yesterday morning. And late in the evening, around midnight, the Lord was shaking me a little. And he says, look, he goes, you didn't write down what I wanted. So start over. So I did. I thought I had the opening. And it wasn't until 3 this morning that I was done. And you know, it's amazing because he starts off like this. Oh, my people, what have I done to you? And how have I wearied you? Testify against me, for I brought you up out of the land of Egypt. I redeemed you from the house of bondage. That's from Micah chapter 6, verses 3 and 4. And you know, church, I know we're not in Egypt. I know we're in the United States. But I know also the Lord has freed us. I know he has taken us out of the bondage. America was founded on religious freedom. He brought us up out of the bondage of religious persecution. There's still religious persecution going on in this world. So when he says that he freed us, it makes sense. But the Lord wants to know, what has he done against us? Is there anybody here that can say one bad thing against God? Nothing at all. Earlier this week, Pastor Sean and I were talking, and again, it came up in our conversation. The book of Revelation, chapter 2, verses 2 through 5. And that reads, I know your works, your labor, your patience, and that you cannot bear those who are evil, and have labored for my name's sake, and have not become weary. Nevertheless, I have this against you, that you have left your first love. Remember therefore from where you have fallen, repent and go back to doing your first works. Amen. You know what, church? This isn't the first time we've been hearing this in these four walls. Over the past couple weeks between Pastor and Sister Esther, and over the past couple months when Pastor was talking about the different letters to the churches, it's come up. And you know what? I have been personally convicted. I know where I have walked away from my first love. But we all need to look at ourselves and see what our first love is. Are we here for lip service? Are we here by name alone as Christians? Or are we going to start returning back to being our first love? Amen. We all need to heed what God is saying. Because now, brothers and sisters, this has to be the absolute most important decision we made since we agreed that Jesus was our Lord and Savior. Because you know what? It's easy to say we're a Christian, we're a follower of Christ. It's easier to say I love the Lord. And it's easy to get lazy with this COVID. It's easy to start being quiet inside. And you know what? I am a loud individual. Amen. And you know what? It's amazing because the Lord gives me so much energy. But you guys get the Spirit, Holy Spirit inside me jumping the louder you get. It's amazing. It's just the way the Lord is. And there are times during these services, I hear people. There's other people in the back. They start clapping. They start singing. They start jumping up and down. And I love it. You know what? That's not me. That's the Holy Spirit saying, that's it. These are my people. You know, I originally didn't want to go in this direction. So I told God, we're not going to need this in the morning. You know what? I'm going to go along with my regular one so I have it as a backup. And thank God I didn't bet him because I really would have lost. And you know what? But he wants me to say this. Rest assured, there is hope and it's not too late. It's not too late for us to return to that first love. We are so blessed, church. Does anybody recall? Does anybody recall Jesus about the ninth hour? He cried out with his voice saying, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. And that is, my God, why have you forsaken me? Does anybody recall that? It's in the Bible. We're getting back to Wednesday night Bible studies, hopefully soon, and we'll cover that one if we need to. But you know, we're so blessed because Jesus died for us. We are never going to have to feel that way. We are never going to have to say, God, why have you forsaken me? Because we are his children. Can I get a praise the Lord? You know what? Thank you, God. Praise the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. Praise him in his mighty firmament. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the sound of the lute and the harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and flutes. Praise him with loud cymbals. Praise him with clashing cymbals. Amen. That is Psalm 150 verses 1 through 5. You know what? We may not have symbols in our hands right now, but they're in our hearts. They're in our eyes. When I'm up here, I'm looking at people's eyes. And I can tell you, people know when I'm making contact with their eyes. And I'm telling you, I feel when your eyes are making it with me. And I know what the Spirit is doing inside of me. So, after hearing that psalm, can we give it another? Let's try it again. Praise the Lord. Amen. Can I get a God is good? God is good. Woo! You know what? Now that our energy is getting moving a little bit, let's try something. Does anybody recall another verse where it said, for he made him who knew no sin to become sin, so we may become the righteousness of him? Does anybody remember that? It's amazing because that's another reason we have to praise the Lord. Can I get a praise the Lord? How awesome is it that Jesus paid our debt for us and we are never going to have to pay that debt? Can I get a God is good? God is There is another verse in Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. It says, and my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. How wonderful is that? Can I get a hallelujah? Everything you are ever going to need. Everything, period. He doesn't say, I'm going to make sure you're going to get a job. He doesn't say, I'll make sure you have some milk and cookies. He says everything, which means he's taking care of our loneliness. He's taking care of our depression. He's taking care of everything. And we know God doesn't lie. And if I stand up here and say, I believe every word of the Bible, then that means when he says everything, he means everything. Can I get a praise the Lord? How about when Jesus looked at everybody and said, with men this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. How great is that? He didn't say, I can just win a football game. He didn't say, I can turn mud and have somebody's eyesight that never seen restored. He said, all things are possible. So you know what? It doesn't matter how big. Doesn't matter how small. You stub your toe, turn around and thank the Lord for it. Or turn around and say, God, why did this happen to me? Don't forget about the Lord when anything happens to you. And you'll see it will change your perspective on anything. I know we're getting tired out there. I know we're getting tired of this COVID. I know we're getting tired of these masks. We're getting tired of people in the stores doing what they want. We're tired of people driving in Lompoc the way they do. We're tired. And some of us struggle with alcohol addiction, drug addiction, pornography, gossiping, smoking, poverty, sickness, loneliness, marital problems, homelessness, self-esteem issues, depression, mobility, work problems, aging, forgetfulness. There's problems with self. Let us remember another verse that Jesus has given us. And it says, for our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. Let us remember that. Can I get a praise the Lord? All this stuff that's happening to us, it's temporary. And the time that we have, does anybody here, I know a bunch of you do. Anybody here remember Brother John? I miss him. I miss seeing him. And I feel him. Because he used to just sit here and he was a great example. There's some of us that aren't going to be here next year. Whether we PCS, whether we go back home, or whether we go to another, the Lord calls us to another congregation. So let's enjoy the time we have with each other and worship with one another. It is strength. So do me a favor, church. Let's do all ourselves a justice. Everybody stand up for a minute. Let's stand up, if you can. If you can. And you know what? I would like everybody to start clapping with me. And just go ahead, follow me. Now repeat after me. Whenever I say something, answer with the word God. Who created you? Who gave you your freedom? Who made you in his image? Who's bringing you back home? Who loves you? Who sent his only son to die for you? And who is it we're worshiping today? Amen. Repeat after me, God is good. And his mercy endures forever. Amen. Have a seat if you'd like. Let us pray. Great and almighty God, you are the only one. You are the great I am. Jehovah Elohim, Adonai, Jehovah Rapha, El Olam, Jehovah Nisi, El Shaddai, Yahweh, El Elyon, Jehovah Shalom, El Roy, our Lord, our God, our friend, our Father, our protector, our comforter, our redeemer, our deliverer, our provider, our forgiver. Awesome and all sovereign God, you are all of these things and so much more. You alone are worthy of all praise. You alone deserve all the honor and the glory. You are the lover of our souls. God, please forgive us. Forgive our sins against you. Allow us not to take advantage of our salvation and your forgiveness when we keep sinning. Father, there are times we don't even realize we're sinning. There are times we're looking at other people and their sins and we forget our own. Father, please allow our hearts and our eyes to be open to you, God. Allow your spirit to flow through us. Allow us to knock those chains off that we keep putting on ourselves. Father, one of the hardest things for us is true repentance. Please, Lord God Almighty, turn us around. Allow us to walk away from that sin, walk away from self, and help us to walk with you. Please free us from the enslavement that we keep putting on ourselves. Allow us not to be like those brood of vipers. Help us not to be those hypocrites. Keep us, please, God, keep us in being a Christian, not in name alone, but following you. God, we know your awesomeness, but we don't always show it. Please forgive us. Allow us to be like the apostles and allow us to show the world. We know even Peter denied you, Christ, but he came back even stronger. Look at how strong he is. Allow us to be that strong. Allow us to be like those apostles. Allow us to be like Paul and not have fear. We may not be in a physical jail, God, but sometimes we get that bondage and we get that jail from our job, from our credit debt, from marital problems, from problems with sin, from problems of pride. God, please, let us shout and leap for joy at the mention of your name. Let us not hold back anymore. We know with you all things are possible. Well, you know what, God? Let's start showing the world, regardless of our age, regardless of our infirmities, regardless of anything that's going on, that we can have that faith and trust in you, and they see the healing, and they keep on saying, who are you with? And you say, I'm with God. Amen. God, let us not be ashamed of the gospel of Christ. Let us not be Americans anymore, or Californians, or we're from the Central Coast. We don't want to be Italian or Mexican or Asian or Irish. We don't want to be anything but your children, God. Please help us, Father, as we cry out to you. Please humble us before you. Bend our knee. Put us down so we know and the rest of the world can see just who you are. Stretch us out, God, and allow us to jump up and sing and dance the way David did. David didn't care what his countrymen thought of him. He didn't care what his wife thought of him. He didn't care because he was one with you, God. We know he made mistakes just like we make mistakes, but God, make us have a heart after your own heart, God. Please, please, God. Thank you, Jesus, for overcoming this world. Thank you for your peace. Thank you for the daily bread that you have given us. Thank you, Jesus, for taking a beating that I will never have to experience. Thank you for hanging on a cross, and I'll never know what that's like. Thank you, Jesus. Because of you, we don't have to deal with that. Thank you, Holy Spirit, for guiding us, for convicting us, for showing us our rights and our wrongs, allowing us to pray, allowing us to sit and be still and know that you are God. Thank you for removing the sin and never having to be alone again. Thank you. Thank you, God. Thank you. Thank you, God. In Jesus' precious name, amen. You know, brothers and sisters, I know I'm long-winded, but this is serious business. Not being up here, being there is serious business. Being a child of God is not easy, but is the most rewarding thing we will ever have. And there's nothing in the world that can top God. And we know how this story ends. So let's bring as many people with us, because it's gonna matter. And you know, brothers and sisters, Jesus says this, peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let your hearts not be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So don't worry about nothing, because you got God's peace. So stop pushing it off to the side. When you ask him for that quarter, you're going to see 75 cents behind it. So stop looking for 25 cents. You want that healing? You first got to trust him. And then you got to just open up your arms, because he's going to pour it on you more than you're ever going to know. So when we talk about worshiping God and praising him, remember, we love because he loved us first. And now let's give him back that love that he gave to us. Can I get a praise the Lord? And the last thing before I forget, I did say the first five verses of Psalm 150, but remember, it ends like this. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Come on, let's praise the Lord together.
amen and amen. Thank you, Lord. You may be seated. We have a small video before we get into worship, but I want to do this. Trev, you're on point. Trev's on point, church. It's what I said in the last couple weeks. Why are we here? Did you come to see what shoes I was going to wear today? It's pretty much the same almost every Sunday. Did you come to see if I was going to wear jeans or not? I wear jeans almost every Sunday. If you came for any other reason this morning but to worship Jesus Christ, I don't mean this wrong, but you came for the wrong reason. And so we're only going to get out of service what we put in. If you put 10% in, you're going to get 10% out of it. Not because God doesn't want to give you 100%, but you're not going fully in. Church, I'm urging, I'm encouraging you this morning as Trev did. Let us go all in this morning. Amen. Do you need Jesus to move in your life?
Amen.
Do you need God to give you some kind of direction this morning? Do you need a touch in your body this morning? Then church, we're in the right place. Let's get there in our hearts. Amen?
Amen.
Go ahead, Tom.
Down to the river,
never the same.
Lord, we come before you this morning as a body, Lord. And we repent for what we've tried to make or turn worship or our services into. Lord, we don't want our way. We don't want to go by this timestamp or our agenda. Lord, we want you. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Holy Spirit, we desire that you be here. We want to commune with you, Lord. Come have your way, Jesus. We love you, Lord.
There's nothing worth more that will ever come close, and no thing can compare your living hope. Your presence, Lord. And I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. It's in your presence, Lord. So we sing, oh Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the comes free and my shame is you
Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. And your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Oh, Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Oh, your glory, God, is what our hearts long to be overcome by your presence, Lord. you, Jesus. Lord, we worship you. We thank you, Lord. We know you're here. We thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Again.
That's who you are.
light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Oh, 'cause even when I can't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. You never stop. Light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Yeah, that is who you are. That is who you are. Healers, who you are. Waymakers, who you are. Almighty's who you are. Wonderful is who you are. God is who you are. Oh, that is who you are. Oh, you way maker, miracle worker. Lord, we worship you. We thank you, Lord, for who you are. Lord, you are so good. You are promise keeper. You are the God of covenant, and you don't break your vow. We thank you, Jesus. We love you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Yes, Lord.
We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord.
God of Abraham, you're the God of covenant, of faithful promises. Time again, you've proven you do just what you say. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn. When you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faith. Age to age, though the earth may pass away, your word remains the same. Yeah, your history can prove there's nothing you can't do. You're faithful and true. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn. When you speak a word, it will come. Faithfulness to me.
From the rising sun to the setting, same, I will praise your name. 'Cause great is your faithfulness to me. Oh, we worship you, Lord. We worship you. Lord, we worship you. We thank you for your faithfulness. We thank you, Jesus. this place. Holy Spirit, fall in this place. Holy Spirit, come fall in this place. As we come to worship you.
Is that your prayer tonight, today? Did you come to worship? Because see, that song is not talking about falling just in this place. It's talking about falling in this place. Church, God has been reaching out to us since we've been meeting. But can I say He's really been reaching out to us about the past 3 or 4 weeks? If you don't feel His presence, you need to check your heart. Because He's here today. He's here today, church. And the enemy has done such a good job, and I mean no props to him, but to distract our hearts, distract our minds, so when we come into church, we can't get into this position. As a matter of fact, some of us are looking at the watch right now going, oh dude, this service is going to be a while. Can I tell you, I need God to do something in my life. And if it takes all day, Nate, then so be it. And I mean that with my heart. The Holy Spirit, fall in this place. God, Thy will be done in my life. I surrender everything, Lord. And I'm not going to listen to the enemy anymore to tell me this, that, and the other. But God, I'm here to worship You. Church, would You worship Him? Just lift your hands and worship the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Not because I've asked you to, but because your heart is in love with Him. Because your heart desires to worship. You can't do anything but worship Him. That's what you want to do. That's what your heart is beckoning you to do. And we're here this morning to do that. Lord, we worship You. I thank You for the very breath I have. I thank You for the blessings You have given, Father God. I thank You for the chains that have been broken in my life. I thank You for the relationships that I have. I thank You for Your Son, Jesus Christ, that has been able to give me life and life more abundant, Jesus. God, I thank You for me trusting in You, and You're going to direct my paths this day. God, I surrender to You. Holy Spirit, in this place today. Break our hearts today. Lord, clear our ears out of the distractions of this world today. That we would fix our eyes and fix our focus upon You this morning, Father. That we would hear Your voice today. There is someone in here this morning that needs to hear the voice of God, that needs to know that He is real this morning. And God says, I'm here. I've not forgotten You. You're not on an island somewhere. I've never left You. I've never forsaken You. Fix your eyes upon Jesus today, church. Fix your eyes upon the King of Kings today. If you need something, He's got the answer. He is the answer this morning. Lord, we worship You. Glory, we give You honor. Lord, I pray for every need in this place today. God, that You would meet each person and meet them at the point of their need today. God, if they need joy, give them joy. If they need peace, give them peace. If they need comfort today, give them comfort today. If they need healing today, then bring healing today. Lord, if they need spiritual revival and a refreshment today, bring it to us today, Lord God. We wait upon You today, Lord, with what You want to do in our lives. I don't want to leave here the way I came in this morning, Jesus. God, Thy will be done. Lord, with us, Father. Let us focus on you the remainder of this service and be sensitive to the Spirit and to your word. In Jesus' precious name. Amen. And amen. This morning, Miss Christina, if you'd come, we're going to be blessed by her. How many enjoy her ministry? I do. It's a blessing. And so this morning I pray that we are blessed yet again. Amen. Amen.
I'm finding myself at a loss for words. And the funny thing is, it's okay. The last thing I need is to be heard, but to hear what you would say. Word of God, speak. Would you pour down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Finding myself in the midst of you, beyond the music, beyond the noise. All that I need is to be with you, and in the quiet hear your voice. Word of God, speak. Would you down like rain, washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. Word of God, speak. Washing my eyes to see your majesty, to be still and know that you're in this place. Please let me stay and rest in your holiness. I'm finding myself at a loss for words.
Been in prayer and you just don't know what to say? You've been talking to God and the Spirit will be moving and you're in the presence of God and you're just like, I have nothing to say. I'm completely lost. That's what it is to be in the presence of the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you, Christina. We are blessed, truly.
Briefly before we get started, I wanted to run through a few announcements. The 28th of February, Sunday, we're going to have Sunday night worship. It's a night of worship, so we invite you guys to come out at 6 p.m. Then the ladies' Bible study is on the 4th of March, and if you're a lady, you need to be here. If you're a dude, just stay in the back, but if you're a lady, you need to be here. Yeah, you can come. I mean, more the merrier, but I know the ladies, I know these ladies, and they can pray, and they can study the Word, and you will be blessed if you show up. I promise you that. And then I want to share something with you that I am really excited about. I've told the story to Miss Judy and probably a couple others that I've been praying about getting back to Sunday night's worship service. How many, growing up, you had Sunday night church, right? That's a good handful of people, right? I mean, so Sunday used to be the day that we'd wake up as kids or whatever, young adults, and we'd wake up and we knew Sunday was the day for church, whether you liked it or not, right? And so I was praying, Lord, do we get back to it? Because there's not a lot of Sunday night services, right? I mean, the church has got away from that. Some churches still do it, but for the gist of it, not a whole bunch. And the Lord laid on my, and I said, well, we're going to do it. I told Miss Judy, I said, we're going to start next year. We're doing Sunday night services every Sunday. And I went home. And God said, did you check with me on that? My God, it's a great idea. Come on. Why are you arguing with me? I mean, Sunday night church, every Sunday. Come on. And God said, check with me on that. And so I put it on pause. It's been a few months since I've said anything about it. And this week, the Lord was upon me. I was praying and seeking the Lord out, and he laid this out. As sure as I'm standing before you, this is God sent. And I had to call Liz. I said, Liz, here's what the Lord's got in plan. Are you good with it? You know, are you down? Can you help us out with it? And she got real excited, and she was all about it. But we are going to begin Sunday services next month. The first Sunday of the month will be, you know, no service. Enjoy your families and, you know, like normal. The second Sunday will be a night of prayer. So just come in and pray. Remember, we used to have hour of prayer. And we've gotten away from it. And can I tell you, I apologize for that. But we're going to get back in there and have a time of prayer, prayer for each other, individual prayer, concert prayer. The third week will be a regular Sunday night service with teaching. And we're going to get other teachers involved so you don't have to listen to me so much. And then the last Sunday will be just straight worship. And we've got some different ideas on how that's going to work. So I'm really excited. I pray you are too. And here's why we're doing this. You say, oh, Lord, more church. We need more church. I think we're in trouble because we don't have enough church. And so I invite you, I know life's busy. I get it. Monday morning comes real quick. But there's just 6 o'clock, you know, evening services. You know, unless the Lord moves, we shouldn't be too late. And if he does, he'll give you the energy for the next morning anyway. Right? So I invite everybody, just mark it on your calendars. This will be kind of what this will be like starting in March. We're going to be blessed on the 21st of March by Pastor Ron. And if you were here, remember Pastor Ron. He was the brother that came and ministered to us at the end of service. He's going to come and minister to us on the 21st. And then I'm really excited about the men's retreat. So we've got a form outside in the Welcome Center to sign up for it. Brochure on the board out there. It's $60 for the weekend. That's going to cover the food and the fuel. The church is going to cover your cabin fee, so you don't have to worry about that. I told Gary, I want as many men as we can get. I want as many guys as we can get. Now, we don't have a whole bunch of guys, so that means that I want all of us to go there. How's that? So we need to know by the 25th of this month, so please make sure to get that signed on, and even if something happens you can't go, just let us know that you're planning on going, because we've got to get the number in there by the 25th so we can make the reservations. Amen. So the Lord's doing stuff here. Amen. And one of the things, we want this campus to grow. We want this campus to flourish. We want it to be more than just a Sunday morning
campus. We know we have the school here, but we want ministries to flourish from this, and that's what the prayer is for this year. Amen? It's good to see Hillary this morning. Good to see you, miss. And Dylan, good to see you as well. It's good to see everybody this morning. Casey, can I borrow you? How many believe the Bible, what the Lord says in giving of your first fruits? Now, you're not going to like what I'm going to say, but if you're having financial difficulties, where's God in your wallet? The old commercial, Capital One, what's in your wallet? Can I just say who's in your wallet? Is it you or God? God says, if you test me in this, right? He uses those words, test me in this and see that I don't blow the house up, right? And can I say today, maybe some of us got to step on the faith dock. Maybe we don't have it. And listen, this money isn't going to me. It's not going to Miss Judy. It goes to the ministry of the church. But can I tell you, you're given to God, right? It's your faith you're given to God, and He will reward that faith. Amen? Lord, we thank you for this day. We ask your anointing upon the remainder of the service and your word. God, we ask you to bless those who can give, and bless those, Lord, who are unable to give right now, and put them in a position to be able to. Let us stretch our faith, Lord God, so that we might have our storehouses overflowing. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Thank you, Casey. If you have your Bibles, I'm going to have you turn to 1 Corinthians 13, 4 through 8, is what the verses we're going to look at. And I don't know, Trev, I don't know what God was up to, because He changed it on you at 3 and He changed it on me at 5. I had a message lined out. I mean, I've got it. It's right here. And at 5 this morning, I woke up and the Lord says, I need you to tweak this a little bit. And I'm just being transparent. I argued with God at 5 o'clock in the morning. I said, God, you're kidding. Right? I mean, I got this whole setup here. This is a great message, Lord. It's Valentine's Day. It's on point. And I came in and I told Tom, and I thanked Tom because he's able to make the changes on the fly. I said, Tom, we've got to change the name of the message. And I only need you to use a few slides. So this morning I want to talk about the true ingredients of love. The true ingredients of love. And I believe next week, if the Lord tarry, this will coincide and go together with today's message. It had been a real big wedding and even a bigger reception, and many people were there. And then came the honeymoon for the couple, and they went to their hotel room. And after they unpacked the bags, the groom took his bride by the hand and they sat on the end of the bed and he looked her in the eye in that moment. And he says, I hope you don't mind, honey. But now that we're married, I thought that I would mention a few little defects that I've noticed about you. She says, not at all, with deceptive sweetness. It was those little defects that kept me from getting a better husband. It's a universal truth. Men who are wise do not tell their wives what's wrong with them. I don't care how long you've been married. She's going to kill me for telling this story. So don't tell her I told the story. Even because I don't know if she watches it online or not. But my wife's back here helping with the kids. So I'm going to try to do it without losing it. So yeah, yesterday, she's doing her makeup. Right? And she looks at me, and she got one eyebrow here and one eyebrow here. And she goes, and she, when she turns and she looks at me and she goes, is there something wrong with my eyebrows? I'm like, it's at that point, men, we've got to question our Christianity. Right? Lord, if I'm honest here, you're going to protect me. Right? And I'd have no clue. I've been married to Penny for 27 years. I've never seen her eyebrows like that. And I'm not kidding. And we laugh. And I go, yeah, there's something wrong. Because I'm very OCD. And if it's not in its right place, I'm going to notice it. And I notice two eyebrows that are on the same page. All right? I mean, she looked like The Rock, you know? You know? I'm so dead. I am so dead. I may not be here next week. But I told her, I said, yeah, there's something wrong. But we don't go out and really nitpick the wives. It's not a very smart thing to do, right? The wives, I think you're born with it. I think you're born with it when you get married to say, do. My wife yesterday, I was wearing, you know, blue jeans and a blue shirt, and I had a gray hat, and I pulled gray socks out. She goes, you can't wear those socks. And I said, no one's going to look at my socks. Nobody can even see my socks. I changed my socks. Yeah. Can I tell you, though, love is funny. They say love at first sight. I'll never forget when I first saw Penn back at Riverview years ago. She was 12, 13 years old. And I was on a row of nothing but guys. Nate, you were there. And I'll never forget saying this to every single one of them. Dude, I'm going to marry that chick. Right? I mean, I said that. And they all laughed. Right? Needless to say, I became her best friend, not her boyfriend. I was that puppy dog in the window guy. Right? For years. But then there came the time where I got an opportunity and we dated. Right? And I don't know, we dated for a year. Right? And I loved Mrs. Long with all of my heart. Of course, it was Miss Stinson back then, my bad. And I'll never forget, she broke up with me. And she'll tell this story she'll make you laugh with it. She broke up with me on a night, and I'll never forget the night, because I went to they used to have these things called phone booths before cell phones. I'll never forget putting my quarter in and calling my dad. Dad, she broke up with me! From a phone booth. That's how distraught I was, right? And she loves to tell that story because apparently I loved her more than she loved me. But I ended up winning. I ended up winning and being blessed by when we got back together and she decided that I was the man that she wanted to spend her life with. And because of that, there's that little man. I love my wife with all of my heart. Men, we love our wives with all of our hearts. Wives, we love our husband with all of our hearts, everything inside of us. With all the mistakes, with all the problems and everything going on. And we learn as you grow in marriage what those little nuances. I have no clue, and I'm sidestepping here, and I apologize because I'm trying to make a point. I have no clue what's going on again with my wife. I am in so much trouble on this message. I have no clue. We've been married almost 27 years, and for the last 6 months, apparently I chew too loud. This is no joke. I'm telling the God honest truth. Last night, I'm about from you to me, Carlina, and I'm quietly, because I know she's going to say something. She's in my head. So I'm quietly dunking my Oreo cookies to make it soft so that it doesn't make a chewing sound. Okay? So here I am. I dunk the chocolate chip cookie. We're watching a show. I get behind her. I chew. And I hear this. Are you kidding me right now? Are you chewing? I'm like, how can you hear that? I mean, it's melting in my mouth. How can you actually? And she yells at me for chewing on ice cream. Something is going on. Right? But we love each other despite our little things. Right? despite me snoring so loud that I can bring a wall down. It's funny because we were at the cabin a couple weeks ago. Nobody else heard me snore or kept him awake. But my wife, boy, all night long, Sean, Sean, Sean. Neither one of us are sleeping, babe. Why don't you go to another room? I did not say that, for the record. I would never say that. I wouldn't be able to walk in front of you if I did. I've said all that to say this. There are true ingredients for love. Jesus Christ exemplifies those ingredients. Paul talks about those ingredients in Corinthians. In the scripture in front of you, there is no ifs, ands, or buts about it. This is what love is. And so our scripture text says this, love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It is not rude. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no records of wrong. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres, and love never fails. That's what true romantic love is all about. Amen? That's what the Bible tells us. He tells us in Ephesians 5:25, husbands, love your wives even as Christ also has loved the church and gave himself for it. Here it is, Valentine's Day. And I posted something this morning, I believe it was, where Valentine's Day, we should love our spouses, we should love friends and our loved ones more than one day. The last time I checked, it's 365 days a year. And yes, our loved ones get on our nerves. Yes, our friends can annoy us. But can I just be honest with you this morning? You don't think you ain't been annoying to God? You don't think you kind of tested His patience? And yet He still loves you. He's still there for you. And so as Christians, how are we to be? We're to allow our light to shine, right? We're to be a different people, a holy people. The only way we can be different is living by love, by the example that we're given through Jesus Christ. That's going to be the difference. Bible says that love is patient. Don't ever pray for patience. You will be in a line for 19 days sometimes. I don't know what it is about, I don't know if this happens to anybody else, but when you're driving down the highway and you get behind somebody that's going slow and you're like, oh, I'm another guy kind of right in front of you. Oh, I think I can make this, right? And so you pull around and you're about to pass the guy and the guy speeds up and now you're stuck between both of them. And they're just both doing 55 miles an hour. Trouble, I didn't ask. If I'm in the grocery store and I'm being a good Christian man and I let the woman in front of me go and she goes and gets groceries and then she pulls out her checkbook. And I'm like, oh, Lord. I should have just checked out. Love is patient. That means when the wife pops off on you about something, chill out. When the husband nags about you or something, have patience. Because I got news flash, nobody's perfect. One is perfect, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
We're not there yet. And so we've got to learn to be patient with those we love, right? That fruit of patience to really set in with us. And trust me, can I tell you this morning? I'm still learning. I'm still learning. It says love is kind. You need to check if you actually love somebody if you ain't nice to them. Hello? If you're mean, if you're ugly, if your attitude's horrible towards somebody, you need to check and say, well, do I actually love you? Right? Because if I'm looking at the ingredient of love here, it says kind. Right? I'm supposed to be kind. My words are supposed to be encouraging, loving. It does not envy. It does not boast. Love is not proud as far as it's all about me. It doesn't put itself first. Let me tell you what, if Christ put himself first, we wouldn't be here today. If Christ in the garden, Roger, had said, you know what? I think I changed my mind. And nobody could have faulted him for it. Nobody could have faulted him for it when if he would have looked upon those soldiers coming up, there on his knees, God, take this cup from me. And said, you know what? Roger's not worth it. I don't love him that much. But that's not what he did. You know what he did? He endured in prayer to where the blood, the drops on his forehead were as blood. There was so much stress and pain, knowing what he was about to go through for you, and me. What he was about to go through for those who would never accept that love. And what did he do? He stood there, they took him, and they hung him on a cross. And he bled. And he died. So that you and me, Margaret, would have hope. So that you and me, Judy, would know exactly what love is. It's putting myself back and putting others first. Laying down my life, my ambitions, my selfishness for my wife, for my church, for my kids, for my God. That's what love is. Love is you not being in the way. I heard something, but somebody said something. The kid, yeah. Love is getting out of the way. Love is stepping out of the way and saying, you go first. I love you more. If you want to check your inventory of friends and family, how are you doing in that department? If we were to put the checklist together between Christ's love and our love, how are we doing? I venture to say each one of us have work to do. Amen? Love says it's not easily angered. Have you found yourself flying off the handle? Have you found yourself so angry that it takes nothing to set you off? Check why. Because love is slow to anger. Let me tell you what. If God was not slow to anger, we'd be in a world of hurt. Amen? But he demonstrates patience. He demonstrates love. He demonstrates comfort and peace. And when I goof up, he doesn't come at me angry. You know, when you first become a parent, one of the first things they tell you is, don't discipline angry, right? If you're mad about the situation when the kid does something, you're supposed to put them in a room or aside, and you need to go. Just calm down. Breathe in, breathe out, pray, whatever you need to do. It's not a bad gig. It's not a bad gig. Because if you're angry when you're disciplined, you're not in the right frame of mind. And I don't care what the kid's done. And so God doesn't come to us angered. Because if he did, some of us wouldn't be here today. But he comes to us with love. And sometimes that love hurts. Discipline's made to hurt. It's not made to feel good. It makes you hurt and change your thought process so that you become more like Christ. That's the reason for it. But isn't it nice to know that God doesn't come to us, love us angrily because of our mistakes? When I fall and I dust my kneecap up, I know that I can get back up, dust my kneecap, and say, God, I'm sorry, on point. And He's right there saying, all's good. Here's how not to do that again. Love keeps no record of wrongdoing. The blood of Jesus Christ keeps no record of wrongdoing. It washes us white as snow. Amen? That love that dripped from His head, His hands, His feet, the wounds upon His body. That blood that dripped was full of love that would wash all wrongdoing away. Some of us need to hear it again. I don't think we quite get it, how important the love, the blood of Jesus Christ truly is. That's where everything happens. The cross is where it all happens. That's where everything that I have done wrong gets washed in the blood. When I come to Christ and I say, Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Cleanse me and make me whole. Those aren't just some words that I'm saying. There's a transformation that happens when I do that. There's the blood of Christ flows into my life, flows into my heart, and washes away all wrongdoing. All sin is washed away by His love. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes. Love never fails. If I wasn't mistaken, I could replace the word love in this scripture with Jesus. Amen. With God. Jesus is patient. Jesus is kind. He does not envy. He does not boast. He is not proud. Jesus is not rude, nor is He self-seeking. Jesus is not easily angered. He keeps no record of wrongdoing. Jesus does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth as He is the truth. Jesus always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. He never fails. Your Lord, Jesus Christ, never fails. Why wouldn't I trust Him? Why wouldn't I trust Him? And that kind of love, church, is the ultimate example of what love is. That is the true ingredients of love. And I would encourage you, go home and study this scripture. And check in that scripture, do you harbor some of those things in there in your heart? Is there anger in your heart? Is there impatience in your heart? Is there rudeness in your heart? Is there pride in your heart? Because if there is, you're going to hurt. You're going to hurt people. We're human. We say things we ought not say. We do things we ought not do. But God, make us sensitive to how I love. Make me sensitive to how I love people. Not just my wife and my kids, but those around me. Because you know what? At the end of the day, church, I want to have that agape love that Jesus Christ exemplifies. That agape love that loves, Nate, that loves you no matter if you love me back. That's what we have to be, church. That's what makes us different people, is loving despite being loved back. And we need to learn how to do that. And in closing this morning, I know that man, has given love a bad name.
I know that there are some that have been hurt in the name of love. And if someone tells you they love you and they have some of these in that definition of their love, I would question their love. Hello?
Yes, sir.
If you're being chopped at, if you're being talked down to, if you're being angered at, if that person don't have patience, if they're not kind, if they're not willing to protect or trust or hope in you or, you know, be there for you, I would question the love. Because there are people out there that will say, hey, I love you, and it's just word lip service. They'll love you as long as they can manipulate you. Hello? Some are looking for love, right? There are so many people today looking for love, looking for that which is called love. We just described what true love is. If you're getting anything else besides that, it's not true love. These kids get married at a young age. They say, I do. They look at each other in front of witnesses and before God, and they say, I do. And they say, I love you. The truth of the matter is, they don't. They've loved the sex, they've loved the company, and they love the convenience. And that's why they divorce a year later. Love is not just something you give up on. And can I just tell you this? Love is not something that just happens. Love takes years. Even as a Christian, when you're here at the altar and you've given your life to Christ, you have a new life. But to say that you love Jesus, right? It takes a minute to learn how to love Jesus. I can love somebody I see, and that still takes time. But I don't see Jesus, but I feel His presence. I sense Him in His Word, and I begin to what? Fall in love with Him. Right? So love takes time. Love takes time. Be patient. But for those who have been hurt, and you say, I don't even know what love is anymore. Can I say this morning, Jesus, the example of love, can heal that hurt if you'll let Him. And He will be more than happy to show you what true love is. True love is not found in a man. It is not found in a woman. It's not found in a dog. It's not found in anything that this world can give you. True love is found in Jesus Christ. And that's what I want to be as an example of. Amen? And I pray that that's ours as well. Let us pray. Lord, I thank You for Your example of love. Lord, it's the ingredients of true love that I want to exemplify in my life. To each and every person that I come in contact with, let me be an example of who You are and the love You have for me to them. God, let me have a love that is patient, a love that is kind. God, a love that does not boast on its own or is proud. God, is not rude. God, that's not self-seeking or selfish, but putting forth people first and their agendas. Lord, let me not be easily angered. Let the love have no tension. God, let me always let that love always protect, always trust, always hope, and be what that You've called me to be as a child of God. God, this isn't an easy thing that we're asking to do this morning. Lord, we're asking You to fill us today with true love, that we might share it with those who may not love us back. God, bolden our spirits, encourage our hearts to love anyway. And God, for those who have been hurt by love, been hurt, their hearts are ripped, their hearts are cut because somebody told them they loved them or did things in the name of love. God, I pray that You would bring healing today. Let there be again a healing in their heart today, and be that example of true love
that you would open their eyes to who you really are in their life. God, this is a journey. So Lord, while we're here each and every day, let us learn to be more like you as we journey to that final day where we stand face to face with you, the ultimate example of love. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen and amen. Church, God bless. Let us go love. Let's go love today. I mean, it's Valentine's Day. If you didn't get your wife flowers or cards or good luck. But I would be serious this morning, church. If we want our church to grow, if you want to grow as a person, begin to love like Christ loved. Amen? God bless. Have a great day. I love each one of you. We'll see you next week.